Okay. Oh, this is the video.
What was our time limit for each month?
Yeah, it's 12:30. So
we only have 15 slides.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. We'll ask questions.
What if we want to see you?
Yeah.
We can go.
Okay, we're ready to go. I'll cue you. Yeah. Thanks, everybody. Apologies for the delay here. We were trying to get the technical issues worked out, but I think we're all set and really excited to talk this morning a little bit about nutrient density and the role it plays in the climate conversation, particularly around animal protein. Before we get into that, I want to introduce myself. I'm Eric Mittenthal. I'm Chief Strategy Officer at the North American Meat Institute and leading the Protein Pact effort for the people, animals, and climate of tomorrow. And want to share a short video on what that's all about before we get started. So let's roll the video. Okay, sounds like the video's not gonna cooperate with us this morning. Oh, there we go.
Our protein pact puts animal agriculture's clear vision and ambitious targets into action. Transparent database reporting verifies progress and keeps us accountable for contributing to global goals. We are committed to continuously improve how we make food with a more positive environmental impact than ever. And further achievements are within reach. Protecting natural resources, supporting farmers' livelihoods, providing good jobs, and making food that families around the world rely on every day. Our commitments are comprehensive, our targets ambitious. For example, to contribute to global climate goals, U.S. pork will reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 40% by 2030. From bars to food service and retail, the U.S. beef value chain aims for climate neutrality by 2040. U.S. dairy has committed to achieve greenhouse gas neutrality or better by 2050. And 100% of the North American Meat Institute's members will have their emissions reduction target approved by the Science-Based Targets Initiative by 2030. While working to optimize their environmental impacts, Protein Pact partners are continuing to produce more nutrient-dense meat, dairy, and eggs the world needs. Meat, dairy, and eggs are the best and sometimes only source of essential nutrients too often lacking in diets globally, in countries at all income levels. Like we have for centuries, people rely on animals for food we need to thrive. And now we are galvanizing everyone, making meat, dairy, and eggs to do so in a way that sustains generations to come. That's why we've made this pact, to provide delicious, nutritious food for families, support livelihoods for farmers and good jobs around the world, while providing the best care for every animal and protecting the land, water, and air we all share. To learn more about our Protein Pact for the people, animals, and the climate of tomorrow, visit theproteinpact.org.
So you can see for us, this discussion is about more than just climate. Climate is a key piece. We're going to talk a little bit about the climate piece of it. But for us, when it comes to animal protein, it's about nutrition. It's about worker safety and worker livelihoods, communities, as well as animal welfare too. So we're working to combine all those issues. And I think for most folks, in terms of their daily lives, all of those issues are on top of people's minds. So this morning, we're really going to be focused on nutrient density and have a panel of great speakers, but also connecting in the climate conversation and how they connect to each other. And so we're going to start off with Diana Rogers, who's a registered dietitian based in the U.S. and with the Global Food Justice Alliance, also wrote the book Sacred Cow. And so I'll turn it over to Diana to talk a little bit about herself and the work that she's doing on the role of nutrient-dense protein for food security.
Great. I'm just testing. Oh, it's working. Great. Hi, I'm Diana Rogers, and I'm really excited to be here to talk a little bit about the unappreciated role that livestock have to food security as far as nutrient density goes. Next slide, please. Next. Okay, so as you may know, meat has been really the focus of attention here as unhealthy, unsustainable, unnecessary, and unethical. And a lot of the work I do through the advocacy work and also my just regular social media channels is push back against all of these ideas. And it's a very complicated narrative that's going on. Next slide. What I think might be happening is that we've got a dilemma here with carbon tunnel vision. So we've got all these people here overly focused on carbon emissions, not respecting the biogenic cycles that come from livestock on well-managed pasture. There are so many other benefits that livestock offer. We're not hearing as much about, you know, as we're being told we need to eat less meat, we need to go to plant-based meat. What does that do to rural communities? What does that do for nutrition status, for malnutrition? So there are so many unrespected aspects to what's going on in the livestock sector right now that I like to highlight. Next. So just briefly, I'm going to be reviewing some of the very recently published data from GAIN, and these slides are from Ty Beale. So we've got malnutrition across the world. This was just published in November 2022, and it has been grossly underestimated what's going on globally with nutrition numbers. One in two preschool age children suffers from at least one nutrient deficiency, and two in three women of reproductive age are suffering from nutrient deficiency. So we need to shift the conversation away from just feeding humans calories to how are we going to feed people the biologically appropriate diet that we need in order for cognitive growth. Next slide. Just a few more on the status of nutrient deficiency worldwide. So 9 in 10 women in African countries, and also in South Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa, have at least one micronutrient deficiency, 9 in 10. Women with at least one micronutrient deficiency, even in the UK. So this is happening even in high income countries, 1 in 2 in the UK and 1 in 3 in the US. Iron deficiency and B12 are among the top ones, with iron deficiency in the US affecting 1 in 5 women. Next slide. This is a chart just showing individual micronutrients and the deficiencies that are happening. And you can see that iron, zinc, and vitamin A and vitamin D are among the top ones. The gray bar is more than one nutrient deficiency. And I'd like to point out here that the majority of these nutrients are best or only found in animal source foods. So the call that everyone needs to eat less meat is not understanding the complex nutritional benefit that we get from animal source foods. And many people do not have the privilege to be pushing away these critical nutrients. Next slide. The prevalence of deficiencies, one or more of three micronutrients. So we see children are the orange bar, and the gray bar is non-pregnant women between 15 and 49. So we see this is just a major problem. Next slide. So key insights from this GAIN report: 1 in 2 children and 2 in 3 women worldwide are affected by micronutrient deficiencies. 9 in 10 children in Pakistan, 8 in 10 in India and Cambodia are deficient in at least one micronutrient. 9 in 10 women in Bangladesh, Cameroon, Cote d'Ivoire, India, and Pakistan are deficient in at least one micronutrient. 1 in 2 women in the UK, 1 in 3. Iron deficiency alone is prevalent in 1 in 5 in both countries. So the widely cited estimate that 2 billion people worldwide are affected is a major underestimate. And I just want to also hammer in again, this is not going to be solved by just eating more fruits and vegetables. We need to solve this with animal source foods. Next. And I just want to briefly point out that the studies that vilify meat are really shaky science. They're based on observational research. Just showing correlation. So here we have the per capita cheese consumption correlates perfectly with the number of people who died becoming tangled in their bed sheets. That's the kind of science that's being used to vilify meat right now. So we have no RCTs showing that pulling meat away from women and children will actually benefit them in any way. And even in the studies, this is showing the studies that are talking about ultra processed meats. And I just want to point out that there's a big difference between relative risk and absolute risk, because the media likes to really twist these numbers. So this is a graphic that I made just showing. So eating 50 grams of processed meat per day may increase your relative risk of colorectal cancer by 18%. And the media will round that up to 20%. And that sounds really scary to the public. But really what that is if you eat 5 pieces of bacon every single day for your entire life, your risk goes from a general risk of, we all have about a 5.6 chance of getting colorectal cancer, to 6.6. 5 pieces of bacon every single day for your whole life. That's what's the difference. But that's not what we hear in the media. That's not what we hear on reports. I mean, when you just enter into Google, does meat cause cancer? Oh yeah, it does, right? And they relate that to cigarettes. That's what these media reports are showing. That's what social media is telling us. But this is the reality. Next slide. This is the only randomized controlled trial, so an experiment showing what happens when kids get a little extra meat. This was done in Kenyan school children. One group got a meat snack at school. One group got a milk snack. One group got extra calories. And then there was a control group that didn't get a snack. And the meat group did better academically, behaviorally, and physically. So we know, contrary to meatless Mondays and vegan Fridays in public schools, that actually giving kids a little extra meat will benefit them in many, many ways. We also have livestock's contribution to food security. I know some of the other speakers are going to be addressing this in one of the next slides, but I also talk about this a lot because you can't just talk about nutrition. We need to talk about all the facets. So livestock can upcycle nutrient-poor food, like waste from the plant-based food industry. For every pound of plant-based protein, there are 4 pounds of food waste. So we can either let that sit in a pile, or we can feed that to livestock and actually turn that into iron and B12 and all the great things that will solve our malnutrition problems. With climate change, livestock are less susceptible to drought and extreme weather. You're not going to lose your entire year's work through a hailstorm or a hurricane. 12% of the world's population relies solely on livestock for their livelihood. So I don't hear Beyond Burger or the other plant-based companies talking about how they're going to support rural communities with new jobs. Plus, women in half the country worldwide are unable to own land, but in many places, in many cases, they actually can own livestock. So getting small livestock to women actually improves the nutrition status and economic status of these homes. One big thing that a lot of people don't understand is that 60% of our agricultural land, it's the numbers, sometimes I see 70%, but I go with the conservative 60%, either too steep, too arid, too rocky, or for other reasons, just cannot be cropped. So there's this public perception, or even in the media, that livestock take up too much lands. And in public schools, the schools that participate in Meatless Mondays have infographics in their schools accusing livestock of taking up 3/4 of our agriculture land without this context. So there's just a lot more going to the story than most people understand. This is my final slide, and just talking about the food sovereignty and ethical dilemma about people with the privilege to push away nutrients, telling other people that they're not allowed to access them. So a vegan or very low meat diet might be possible if you live near a Whole Foods market, or if you live in a place that actually has all the supplements that you need, but it's probably not possible for the majority of people on this planet. All people deserve access to nutrient-dense food, regionally produced, sustainable, and culturally appropriate food. We know that meat is culturally appropriate in just about every culture. And certainly animal source foods are in the majority of cultures. Legumes and grains, while they can be included in a healthy diet, are not a substitute. So you can get about 30 grams of protein from 180 calories worth of beef, or you can get 30 grams of protein from 750 calories worth of beans and rice. And you're still not going to get the iron, the B12, all the other micronutrients that you can get from that small package of red meat. Ultra-processed plant-based proteins are not nutritionally equivalent, and they have their own sustainability concerns. I don't see any of them being produced with organically grown corn or soy or wheat or any of those products. They are the result of chemical monocrops that are destroying entire ecosystems. So while they may have a nice carbon credit score, they may produce less emissions, they have massive ramifications environmentally. Finally, just removing, taxing, or forcing the restriction of animal source foods by those with privilege is cultural and moral imperialism.
All right, thank you very much, Diana. So good overall perspective on the role of meat and animal protein on nutrient density. Now we're going to dive in a little bit further on some of the benefits of some of the nutrients and the role in our development from those nutrients with Dr. Bola Adegosan from University of Florida, and talk a little bit about your program, and we'll get into your presentation.
Thank you very much, Eric. Really appreciate the invitation to participate today. I'm going to be talking about what I call brain foods. And you may have not heard them described in those terms, but hopefully after my presentation, you will see why I call animal source foods brain foods. I'm an associate vice president at the University of Florida, and I direct the USAID and Gates funded livestock systems, Feed the Future Innovation Lab for Livestock Systems, and also the Global Food Institute. So my first slide talks about this terrible situation called stunting, which we're all familiar with. And I call it a preventable tragedy because it kills almost half of children under 5. And these are pre-COVID numbers. So 144 million children are stunted, so they don't achieve their high potential because of undernutrition, particularly in infancy. And what's really problematic here is that it's not just that they have physical growth impairment, but there's also cognitive impairment. And these children are much more susceptible to diseases, and this is an intergenerational problem. So a mother who is stunted is more likely to have stunted children. Next, please. Now, when we look at where stunting is concentrated in the world, it's in much of Saharan Africa and South Asia. And in fact, on average, 1 in 3 children in these areas is stunted. And someone said stunting condemns children to a lifetime of under a performance and underachievement. So it's a life sentence. And you can see that that one in three children is bad enough, but we work in seven African countries, and in some of those regions, in some of those countries, it's two in three children. So it's a very, very worrying problem. Next slide, please. Now, we're talking about animal source foods, and this is a statement in the WHO report in 2017, that these animal source foods are the best source of high quality nutrients for infants after they're weaned in the first 1,000 days of life. So we're going to look into why WHO would make such an outstanding statement. The other thing I put there is, again, these are pre-COVID data. This is a slide from UNICEF showing that almost 60% of children around the world are not getting the vitally important micronutrients that they need from these animal source foods. So Diana referenced and very nicely showed the levels of malnutrition in different countries and nutrient deficiencies, one or more. And animal source foods can meet those micronutrient deficiencies, but they're not because of different reasons like unaffordability, inaccessibility, and then perceptions, some of them from the West, which discourage these kids who need it most, the pregnant and nursing mothers who need it most, from consuming those animal source foods. Next slide, please. So when we look at animal source foods, we can compare them to staples. There's no comparison, but even if you compare them to fruit, nuts, fruits and vegetables that are nutrient dense, they stand out. Why do they stand out? Because of the micronutrients and macronutrients. So if we think about the protein concentration is usually more in the animal source foods, but what's more important is the profile of amino acids, the quality of the protein to serve as a building block for growth. And the animal source foods are, that's why they're called ideal proteins, because they have the perfect composition. And then you have a whole number of micronutrients that are much more bioavailable from the animal sources. That means they're much more readily absorbed. So it's not so much about how much of a micronutrient is in a food type, it's how much you can get from that food type. And the animal sources are much more absorbable. So iron, zinc, calcium, vitamin B12, you only get that from the animal sources, yet it plays such an important role in the nervous system, in transmission of messaging and so on. Vitamin A, D3, and so on. So you can see that the animal sources are either the only preformed natural source or the most bioavailable source. And this is why they stand out. Next slide, please. So if we look at this on the left, the graphic on the left is a list of different food types by iron concentration. Diana nicely showed the levels of iron deficiency in Western countries and a number of countries across the world, and showed how prevalent the problem is. And so you might think that by eating some of these foods at the bottom there, some of the vegetables, spinach and so on, that are high in iron, you can easily meet those micronutrient deficiencies. But again, remember, it is not the concentration that's important. It's more of how much of what is in the plant is absorbable. And if you look on the right-hand side, you can see that it is the animal sources that are much more absorbable because of their higher bioavailability. So this is a very key point to bear in mind. And then if we go on to the next slide, I'm trying to drive this home a little bit more with one more graphic. So a woman of reproductive age, if we look at how much iron, how much of different food types she's going to need to eat to get her iron needs met. And remember what Diana said about the deficiency levels in the US, in the UK, and in many other countries, very high, particularly in the developing world. So that woman would need to eat about six times, what's that number there? That's 2.4 kilograms of spinach. So if you eat 2.4 kilos of spinach, please put up your hand, okay? So, you know, it's almost unthinkable to eat that much spinach. Spinach is a good source, but the bioavailability is less. And consequently, eating a little bit of liver or meat will provide the much needed iron for that woman in a much more realistic portion size. And again, it's because of the type of iron, which is much more bioavailable and absorbable. Next slide, please. Another important thing to remember is the role of these micronutrients in cognition. And some of you will remember the graph on the left-hand side, the graphic, which you probably studied when you were in school. So taking you back to those days, which may bring back good or not so good memories. But you have the structure of a neuron, and then you have the synapse, and the blue sheaths surrounding the tail of the neuron are the myelin sheaths. So you might ask, why is that all important? Why is the synapse important? Well, this is the unit of messaging in the brain. So it's very, very important for cognition, for the ability to think, and so on. And next slide. When we look at, when we look at the development of different processes in the infant brain, in the first few months of life, visual and auditory processing is developed. So it's really vital to ensure that what is needed for those processes are supplied. Then if you look at synaptic refinement, myelination, synaptogenesis, all those three are important and related to the figure I just showed you. And if you don't have a ready supply of micronutrients for that small brain of a child that's just growing, then you're going to have malformation in the brain. And so this is very critical in the first 1,000 days of life. You can see that brain volume, again, is almost completely fixed by the time the child is 2, 2.5 years old. So again, brain volume is a measure of cognition. All these important processes require essential micronutrients. And if they're deficient, they cause problems such as they contribute to stunting. Next slide, please. So, and please click twice more. And so on the left-hand side, you see the nutrients that are critical for brain development. And then please click once more. Those micronutrients on the left-hand side, almost all of them, over 90% of them, you would get in animal source foods, and you would get a much more readily supplied supply for the brain, that small brain of that child. And if those micronutrients are not supplied, then you have all these issues: lower IQ, poorer cognition, smaller brain size, growth failure, and so on and so forth. So this is one of the things that I think is very important for all of us to keep in mind. Next slide. Diana referenced this study in Kenya that showed that adding a little bit of meat, a matchbox size of meat, to the diet of school children increased their exam scores across all subjects. The increase was by 45%. So it's phenomenal. When milk was added, it increased their test scores by 28%. These were 7 to 10 year olds. So these are huge improvements, and due to just adding a little bit of an animal source food supplement to the diet of the kids. Next one, please. Again, when the environmental impact of livestock products is considered, people don't usually weigh that against the nutrient density. And Ty Beal very nicely accounted for the greenhouse gas emissions of different food types, but in this case, he weighted it by the nutrient density. And you can see when you look at it that the refined grains or even regular grains and other plant products are far more polluting when you account for the nutrient density you get from the livestock products. Next one, please. Another point to make is that, you know, the US meat industry and a lot of the organizations in the West that are involved in livestock production have already set targets for being completely carbon neutral. I think by 2050, all of them will be. So there are many approaches, strategies, and in which we can use to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from livestock systems. And some of those are already being used. But in the global South, we need to increase utilization of some of those climate smart approaches. And that's why, can we go to the next slide, please? That's what we focus on in our work in the Livestock Systems Innovation Lab. We work in 9 countries in Asia and Africa. And our vision and our goal is to sustainably intensify livestock production in order to improve the nutrition, the health, the incomes, and the livelihoods of children in these countries. So livestock products are vital, not just for health and nutrition, but even the GDP. So the World Bank researchers have shown data that lack of animal source foods in the diet, or in countries where stunting is very prevalent, the GDP of those countries is reduced by 7% on average. In Ethiopia, they told me the number is 16%. So these animal source foods play such a vital role, not just in personal health and well-being, but also in national development and national economies. Next slide. So I'm going to share just three of the projects. We have over 60 projects that we have been conducting in the developing world that are geared towards increasing production, marketing, conservation, and consumption of livestock products. This is one focusing on eggs, and it was done in Burkina Faso in West Africa. And what we did is we targeted a group, a tribe, where egg consumption is not common. In fact, it's a taboo. And we worked with village elders to convince them to identify families that would give an egg a day to a child. And we trained the families on the importance of eggs in the diet and the importance of poultry production. At the end of our training period, the children were eating 6 eggs a week. Those in the control group were eating 0 eggs a week. So we were able to reduce underweight and wasting, which, as we all know, is linked to child mortality. So this made the national news. The women were empowered. We measured it statistically. So this is one example of our project. Next slide, please. Another thing that we have done work in several of our countries on pathogens, on aflatoxin in milk. But what I'm going to share in this case is a study that we did to look at the USDA, the FDA, and EU standards for the safe levels of aflatoxin in milk. And we looked at whether those are risk-based or not. We discovered that they are not risk-based, that in fact, they are causing, as we've shown here, a mountain out of a molehill, because the standards, we discover that the risk of cancer from consuming milk contaminated with aflatoxin, the global number of people affected by that in a year is 32 at the most. And we're not even sure that is due to the aflatoxin. So we published a paper in the Journal of Clinical Nutrition on this, really standing against some of those standards, and some of the African countries are now beginning to revise their standards, because that means that they don't have to dump so much milk that could nourish their children. Next slide, please. We also did a survey of the levels of the link between meat consumption and cognition. And this survey included about 10,000 children from several different countries that you can see there. And we found that for 45%, there was a 45% association or increase. As meat consumption increased, cognition of children increased 45% of the time. 26% of the time it decreased, but we discovered that that was associated with children that had HIV. And if you took out the HIV, which is a confounding factor, the number went from 45 to 75%. So that's a staggering a metric showing a link between cognition and meat consumption. Clearly, more research is needed in this area. Next slide. So as a result of this work we're doing, our university has now created an institute, which I am privileged to direct, that looks at meat, but other nutrient livestock products, as well as other nutrient dense sources of nutrition. But by far, the livestock products are the best source, particularly for infants, particularly for young growing children, even teenagers. In the UK, we hear about rickets resurging, partly because, you know, the children, the young teenagers are drinking alternatives to milk, which contains so many of these vital micronutrients, and also for the elderly. So these animal source foods are vital really important for cognition, for growth, for health, and they also contribute to development of entire economies. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I wanted to now bring in this perspective of Dr. Mohamed Ibrahim of Kati and talk a little bit about nutrient density in the context of food systems and livestock raising practices. So tell us a little bit about Kati and welcome your presentation.
Okay, thank you very much for inviting me for participating in this panel. Kati is a higher education research and development institution based in Costa Rica. Assistant institution of ICA, we work very closely with ICA, working on policies, and we appreciate the invitation from ICA to participate in this event also. So the previous speakers have been focusing more on the nutrient density from a perspective on the impacts of growth and nutrition. And my presentation will address more the issues on livestock and the environment, which I've been working over the last 30 years with the Livestock Environment Development Initiative and the Global Agenda for Livestock, et cetera. Because as you see the discussions, most of the issues on climate change, but also on environmental degradation, is within the system limits or the boundaries where from a farm or landscape level. Of course, there are the issues on the processing plants, et cetera. Next slide, please. So the numbers there that are presented shows the importance of livestock in the Latin LAC in terms of numbers and the contribution to the economies, but also in terms of intake as well as the contribution to the livelihoods of people in Latin America. And for this reason, livestock plays an important role in terms of the land use, but also there are issues which we see livestock as a part of the solution to the problem of climate change, but also at environmental degradation. Next. Just to mention that the inefficiencies that exist, we still see opportunities where there are productivity gaps, but also gaps in the emission intensities, which is an important opportunity for us to look at as trying to refocus in terms of more production efficiencies, but also reducing emissions, but setting the frontiers where you're going to have a net zero in terms of the emissions, which are the targets that they're facing on. Next. So Kati as an institution has been working more at a landscape approach, understanding the processes of landscape, the importance of livestock within shaping the landscape, but also in terms of conservation of biodiversity, looking at productivity, water and governance, etc., and also looking at policies and incentives to promoting more uptake of improved technologies. Next. Recent study that we did with the FDA shows that there is good tree cover in the landscape, more room for improving the tree cover and tree resources that are playing important role in terms of biodiversity, carbon, and also ecosystem services. And therefore, our work has been more focused on silvopastoral systems in addition to improved feeding practices that we've been working on. Next. So an example of work that we have a good database and what are the importance of these practices in terms of conservation of biodiversity, which you've seen from the IPBS report of looking at the synergies between adaptation and mitigation to climate change, but at the same time, what are the core benefits in terms of conservation of biodiversity and the sustainable use of biodiversity. We have got good data which is showing that these systems do contribute towards conserving biodiversity at the landscape level. Next. But also understanding the impacts of heat stress, as you can see from the news in Africa, the drought is forcing the sales of cattle, which before you can sell at $900 per head of cattle. Today, the farmers are selling for 100 head of per head of cattle, $100. So looking at the mitigation, the adaptation aspect and resilience, we have been working on looking at the shade trees and reducing heat stress, improving the productivity, and at the same time having the co-benefits in the carbon as well as biodiversity conservation. Our data is showing where you can improve productivity up to 15% only having only shade trees in the pastures, but also improving water consumption, etc. Next. But also, inflation now is forcing farmers to look at alternatives for feeding. The high prices for concentrates understanding the trade-offs that you're going to have in emission of greenhouse gases. That's an area that we've been focusing, looking at better forages for improving the productivity and milk productivity, but also beef that is being produced. Kati has been working on looking at improved feeding systems as a source of the base for improving the productivity on these farms. And these are some data that is showing what relatively good production levels from these systems. So also we have been advancing looking at the genetic improvements with looking at traits that are more adapted to the heat conditions and stress, but multiple traits in terms of productivity and looking at emission intensities. And at our Kati's farm, we have got crosses which is showing up to 5,000, more than 5,000 liters of milk per lactation, which is relatively high compared to what are the traditional systems, looking at how you can bridge the productivity gaps that we've been working on. And we are now in the process of scaling out these type of technological improvements that we've got up. Next. An example of data, looking at the metrics that we've been measuring in terms of the productivity, emission intensities of per cow has been reduced in terms of liters of milk produced, as well as for lactation, as to show the gains that we're having in terms of reduction of emissions. Next. These are the metrics. If you're looking at the baseline indicators, we think that baseline information is important, but also looking at the additionality that you're going to have in terms of mitigation. These practices do reduce the emission intensities, emissions of greenhouse gases, and at the same time, they're improving productivity on the farms. From a farmer's perspective, it's important to look at the profitability, but also understanding the risks that they're facing, and how do you help the farmers to overcome the risk factors that they're undertaking. Next. But it's very important to look at the metrics that we are using at. The IPCC, based on our data that we are looking at in terms of emissions of ammonia, measured from IPCC 2006, but adjusted in 2019, but compared the European standards, we see that there's over an estimation in terms of emissions that some of the IPCC methods have been used. So we think that there's need for better estimation for tropical conditions, where we think that the data can be refined to look at what is the real footprint of the emissions that we're having from these animal source proteins that have been produced. Next. So Kati's been working also together with the institutes and looking at carbon removals with silvopastoral practices. They're good examples where we see that in Latin America, we can enhance the carbon sequestration for us as a tool for mitigation to climate change. We see that there's a good objective where farmers can be getting more incentives from the carbon credits that are producing in the farms, but also reaching the carbon neutrality, as we've seen in the case of Uruguay, which are already exporting carbon neutral beef already. Next. A data on our farm, which we're showing that only trees on the live fences, if you will go in Central America, 90% of the farmers are managing live fences and the farms, offsetting 28% of the emissions that we have got on our farms that we're working on. And together with the soil carbon and the other stocks that we have, we show that the good data where we are moving towards carbon neutrality in these farms that we have. Next. This morning, one of the speakers mentioned about the importance of looking at the typologies of the farm, from a systems approach, understanding where are the opportunities that you can target to have more efficiencies. This is the work that we did with EC LEDs with the University of Wisconsin, which are looking at what are the emission factors and the sources that you have in the different systems. Understanding that in Latin America, that the systems can be very based on the agroecological conditions that you're working on. If there are more intensive dairy systems or more dual purpose cattle systems. So based on the intensity of the feeding, but also on the location, the emission intensities are varying, and there's where we see some opportunities where we can do some targeting to reduce the emission intensities. Next. But also from a decision-making perspective, there is a lack of information from the economics in terms of the marginal abatement cost curves, which Kati has been working to look at which are the technologies that will have better responses, and you can see that these technologies in terms of animal health, better management, are the one that are giving better responses in terms of a dollar invested in terms of productivity, but also in reduction of emissions. Silver pastoral practices, which are pretty good for mitigation objectives, also in addition to conservation of biodiversity, needs more incentives for the farmers to remove the barriers for investment in these practices. And that's something that we've been working with the policymakers to look at, what are the blended finance mechanism that will remove this barrier for adoption of more of the silver pastoral practices. Next. So I would like to finish in showing that we are currently implementing two important projects, one with the NAMA facility for transforming the Honduras livestock sector into a low carbon economy. That's a new project that's been started. Next. This project, we have seen already what is the matrix of the system to use in the farms to look at the carbon neutrality in terms of the transition of good pastures of our silver pastoral systems and good practices. How do you going to move to this, the carbon neutrality? Next. An example of how the impacts of the direct and indirect impacts of this project is going to look at reducing the emissions, understanding that Honduras has got its NDC, livestock as part of the NDCs to reduce the emissions, and how it's going to advance over the next 20 years for reaching this objective for reduced emissions from the livestock sector. Next. Another project that is, we are starting up in Dominican Republic, the Guatemala, Honduras, and Panama and Costa Rica, will look at policies and governance structure for implementing carbon neutral livestock systems to understand how we move from scales from a pilot level towards a more national policies and regional policies, which is important to look at obtaining this carbon neutrality of livestock systems. It's going to focus in terms of governance, extension, et cetera. And finally, I would like to say that we have been working more on the carbon circularity of the livestock systems, where I think that animal proteins is going to continue to be important, but if the demand for more vegetable proteins is going to increase, integrating livestock, mixed livestock systems is going to be an important role for reaching these objectives. We have some data which is showing already how contributing towards improving the meat and milk, but also in terms of water savings on energy costs with biogas converted to electricity in the farms. We have got the savings already in terms of the carbon footprint, but also in terms of the economy of the farms, but also managing the manure for fertilizers and organic fertilizers through the crop rotations are examples where we're getting on-site benefits, but off-site benefits through ecosystem services as a model of transitions towards the circularity. Those are some examples of the work that Kathy has been working on the new carbon neutrality. There's a good forage species in the tropics, which we are working on. And I think we need to continue developing these systems and transitioning towards more carbon neutrality of the systems. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Really great examples of opportunities for reductions and pathways for us to do that. Our final speaker comes to us via recording, Dr. Frank Mitlerner at the CLEAR Center at UC Davis, and talking a little about.
I'm at the University of California in Davis, so the Department of Animal Science.
Yeah, sure. Talking a little bit about methane accounting and the new science around that and how that plays into this discussion as well.
Hello, everybody. My name is Frank Mitlerner. I'm at the University of California in Davis, in the Department of Animal Science. And I was asked to talk to you about how managing methane for livestock should be part of the climate solution. It is no secret that methane is much more potent in trapping heat from the sun than, let's say, CO2. And in order to compare various gases like methane and nitrous oxide to CO2, a matrix is generally used called GWP 100 or global warming potential 100. It has been used for the last 30 years. And what it really says is that methane is approximately 28 times more powerful as a greenhouse gas than CO2. However, this matrix has recently come under scrutiny. Here's some of the reasons as to why. Methane, in contrast to other greenhouse gases, is not just produced, it's also destroyed. What you see on this slide here is the global methane budget. It shows that on the left side, there are numerous sources, including fossil fuel production, use, agricultural waste, and so on. All of these amount to what you see in the first half bubble, the source emissions, and they amount to 576 teragrams of methane being produced. But on the right side of this graph, you see that there are also sinks for methane. In other words, there is an atmospheric removal of methane. And that means that the methane is not just produced, it's also destroyed. And if you have a constant source of this gas from a given source, let's say cattle herd, constant cattle herd, then an equal amount of methane that's produced is also destroyed, roughly equal. The lifespan of the half-life of methane is a little over a decade. And that's in sharp contrast to other greenhouse gases, CO2 and nitrous oxide, which are considered longer climate blooms with a lifespan of hundreds to 1,000 years. So that makes methane significantly different. Colleagues of mine from Oxford University some time ago looked at the matrix, at this GWP100 matrix for methane, and they concluded that the GWP100 does not characterize the warming impact of this gas accurately, and that it might significantly, in some cases, under, in others, overestimate the impact methane has on warming. And so they said, that was years ago, that if you use this old GWP100 matrix, that you might overblow the true warming impacts on a constant source of methane on warming by a factor of 3 to 4. In fact, this very statement that I just made was taken on by the IPCC AR6 report. Now on page 123, it states now exactly that, that a constant source of methane will characterize by GWP100 will overblow the warming impacts by a factor of 3 to 4. So those colleagues from Oxford then developed an alternative matrix for methane, and that's called GWP star. GWP star actually predicts the actual warming impact of this gas, and it accounts for not just the production, but also the destruction. So the atmosphere half-life better, and the behavior that this gas has on producing warming. This slide here shows a screenshot of the IPCC AR6 report. Surrounded here, highlighted, is what the IPCC says. The characterization is of GWP100 when you use constant sources. They said, what I just quoted the Oxford folks to say, that this gas is overblowing constant sources by a factor of 3 to 4 when it comes to warming. Now, we all know that CO2 is a stop gas. It accumulates. If you burn, let's say, fossil fuels on one day, we do the same thing the next day, then it's cumulative. Every time we burn fossil fuels, we add additional carbon to the atmosphere, it accumulates. You always add to the existing stock, making this gas a stop gas. Currently, many people consider methane as if it were a stop gas too, as if it were to accumulate just like CO2 does. In other words, every time, let's say, rumen belches, as if that were additional methane that is added to the atmosphere. But methane is really not a stock gas, it's a flow gas. It's not just produced, it's also destroyed. And any kind of matrix must account for that. So if you have a constant source of methane, let's say, on the farm, constant herd, then the amount of methane produced by this constant number of animals and the amount of methane destroyed through this so-called hydroxyl oxidation, this atmospheric removal process, are roughly in balance. That means a constant source of methane does not add new additional warming to the planet. But if we reduce methane, then we have the ability to reduce warming. And that's what gives us a real opportunity to become part of a climate solution. If you have two sources of CO2 on the one and methane on the other, that increase, then both of them need to, you see on this slide here in the bottom panel, need to increases in the resulting water. But CO2 will lead to an exponential increase in warming because it's cumulative, whereas methane is not cumulative. If we have constant sources of both CO2 and methane, then the constant release of CO2 will lead to an increasing amount of warming, whereas a constant source of methane leads to constant warming, no additional. And that already shows that these two gases have different behavior insofar how they warm the planet. What I find most interesting is what happens when you reduce both CO2 and methane. It happens in resulting warming. Let's take a look at this decreasing amount of CO2 over time here in the right top panel. You see when you decrease CO2, then you still increase warming. And you increase the warming all the way until you stop the CO2 emissions. The same is not true for methane. When we reduce methane, we instantaneously reduce warming. And so that should really be our goal of using the specific behavior of this gas on warming to our advantage and mitigate methane so that we can reduce warming in the short term. This slide here shows three scenarios, the increasing, the stable, and decreasing methane that's produced over a given source, the time horizon is 30 years. And I will now show you how this old matrix DWP100 characterizes these three scenarios versus how GWP started. So for GWP100, we see that in all three cases, we're adding a significant amount of additional CO2 equivalent emissions. It treats the methane as if it were a stop gas, not a flue gas. We know that's wrong. On the right side here, you see how GWP star, this Oxford matrix, how that characterizes the three scenarios, the increasing of the stable and the decreasing stable. GWP star agrees with GWP 100 only in the top scenario. In the second scenario, where methane falls slightly by 10% over 30 years, you see that there's all of a sudden no blue north of the excess, meaning no additional warming caused by this gas that decreases over time. In fact, you now see a little bit of blue, which is the warming south of the x-axis, and the negative sign in front of the number. The negative sign indicates negative warming. And in the bottom right panel, you see that if you have a strong reduction of methane, let's say by 35%, then you have a strong reduction of warming. That's the blue south of the x-axis, indicating that we are now pulling carbon from the atmosphere. And that is the similar effect as if we were to plant trees, which do the same thing. So a strong reduction of methane can reduce warming. That's the bottom line. And that's exactly where we want to go. Can that be done, is the question. Well, in California, we have probably the most aggressive law on methane to be found anywhere in the world. The law says that we need to reduce methane by 14% or zero over the next 8 years. And this 40% reduction shall be achieved through a process in which the state of California partners with the farming sector. Partners insofar that methane reduction equipment will be purchased, but the cost shared between public and private partners. The dairy industry in the state of California, which is the largest in the country, in the United States, went about reducing methane in the following way. The lagoons where the manure is stored that normally are open have now been covered. And you can see it on this slide here at the bottom right. This lagoon cover now traps the gases that are generated from the lagoon, it's called biogas, and 60% of that biogas is methane. In Europe, most digesters, anaerobic digesters, are used to produce biogas too. But in those countries, the biogas is normally burned and made into power. Not here in California. We are taking the biogas, we're cleaning it up, and making it into transportation fuels for renewable natural gas, RNG. And this renewable natural gas then goes into semi-trucks and buses to replace diesel. Here you see such a fueling station where the dairy RNG, renewable natural gas, is put into those semi-trucks. And again, instead of being fueled with diesel and instead of burning diesel, these things are now fueled by renewable natural gas, which burns much cleaner than the diesel. So our state is happy about the general outcome because we see a double value effect here. We see a reduction of emissions on the dairies, less methane going into the atmosphere there. And we see a reduction of emissions from the vehicle fleet. And that is a double whammy that the state is happy to achieve. So we have less greenhouse gases in the atmosphere and less air pollution as a result. And the dairy sector is actually making money by doing so because they can sell the credits, the so-called low carbon food standard credits, and these credits pay for a lot of these investments. In addition to reductions from animal manure, we also study a lot of feed additives that you can feed to animals in order to reduce what these animals belch out, what comes out of their mouth. And that's methane. The feed additives that you see listed here have various reduction effectiveness associated with them. And so we are quite bullish to predict that within the next 5 years or so, we will have feed additives in the shelf or on the shelf that allow a farmer to reduce entire emissions by anywhere between 10 to 13%. So we already see a significant reduction of methane from the manure side of things. And by the way, that's making up the lion's share right now. Just to give you an idea, in the state of California, from 7 million metric tons that are released by the dairy sector, the reductions we have achieved already are 2 million metric tons, 2.2 actually. So we are making real progress. But in the future, we add to that the newer progress also the effectiveness of these energy mitigation strategies. We do this in order to get our dairy industry to a point of climate neutrality. On this slide, you see on the x-axis, the years depicted, on the y-axis, the global equivalents. In gray, you see the business as usual scenario. This is what were to happen with our warming for the dairy sector if we don't do anything. In light blue, you see what happens if we reduce methane emissions from manure storages by 40%. And in dark blue, you see what happens if we do both manure and enteric reductions. And as you can see here, at some point in the year 2027, when we do the mitigation, we will cross the x-axis, and that means become climate neutral. Climate neutral means simply that we don't add additional water to our planet. If you go beyond climate neutral, then you reduce historic contributions of the sector to the warming. And so this is the path we are on. We call it the path to climate neutrality. We are pursuing it aggressively, helping farmers find solutions to reduce emissions to achieve a real world impact on our climate. We have published our work, see here in the Journal of Dairy Science, an article that shows how we can follow a pathway to climate neutrality and achieve that point in the near future. I'm the director of the CLEAR Center here at UC Davis. I just wanted to say at the very end here, we do both research and we communicate that research with the interested public, but also with an interested farming and government sector. So we do both research and extension, and we weigh both equally important. With that, I want to leave the webpage of our center here for you. Contact us if you have any questions. We'll be glad to entertain those. So thanks very much. Good luck with the rest of the conference.
Thank you to Dr. Mitlerner for doing that for us. He teaches too, so he's actually teaching this semester and couldn't join us here. I wanted to open up for questions. Folks have questions for us. I know I have a few prepared. And the first one I want to start off with is, I think, as we have these discussions around nutrition and nutrient density and the role of animal protein, so much of the debate becomes polarized, plants or animals. And Diana Bola, I wanted to get your perspectives in particular on the value of having them in combination and what that provides from a nutrition perspective and the benefits of combining meat and vegetables and other plants.
We probably agree on this, but definitely plants plus vegetables and fruits are good things. In the US, 60% of our diet is ultra processed foods. And when we hear so much about how we need to be only looking at meat, it actually allows ultra processed foods, which are nutrient poor, to kind of get a free ride. And so we really need to be looking at our overconsumption of empty calories that stimulate overeating, and really focus. The whole entire conversation needs to shift to nutrient density. Folate is also a common nutrient that is, you know, showed up on the slides that I showed. The word folate comes from foliage. It's best found in leafy green vegetables. So definitely plants and vegetables, with some fruits as well are ideal.
Thank you. I would agree. And since Diana spoke about the West, I'll speak about the global South. In many parts of the developing world, particularly in the rural areas, people are vegetarians, not by choice, but by force, because livestock products are expensive, they are not accessible, or for other reasons. Many of the development agencies, governors, donors, and so on have focused on fortification as a method of addressing that issue, which is good, but is a challenge because often those strategies are only focusing on supplying one missing nutrient, and several are typically missing. A diversified diet is what we should be aiming at. We should have meat, we should have the fruits and vegetables, we should have the nuts as part of the diet, whether it's in the West or whether it's in the Global South. The need is, I would argue, maybe even greater in the Global South because people are forced to eat these nutrient deficient diets and they vitally need these livestock products. But you know, you can't subsist for long periods, or it's very challenging to subsist for long periods on livestock products alone. So what we need to focus on is diet diversity that includes the livestock products as well as the fruits and vegetables with the staple. And we need to do a lot more to educate people about nutrients in the Global South. I don't mean in the big cities. I mean in the rural areas, because there is a lot of lack of awareness of what nutrients are and how vital they are. I spoke to people in Niger in a village some time ago and said, well, do you understand this concept? They said, no, we don't. What? Why do you eat? We eat to fill our stomachs. Now, this is in a rural area. If you go into a city, of course, people know what nutrients are. So we need to do a lot more educating about diet diversity that includes livestock products as well as fruits and vegetables. And so, thank you.
Sorry, you touched on the next topic I want to talk about is the cultural context, and how diets vary based on your cultural context. How does that issue play in here and the importance of maintaining the cultural relevance of different foods that you know are enjoyed across cultures?
Okay. So culture is huge. We've discovered this in our work in the 9 countries. So in Nepal, like in India, dairy products are consumed in very large amounts, but beef is not, because of the religion. And you have to respect that. And so we have to use approaches that are context appropriate. In Nepal, we push a lot of dairy production. A lot of the dairy, most of the milk that's consumed in Nepal is not from cows, it's from buffalo. So we've worked, for instance, to reduce the level of mastitis, which is a disease that reduces milk production from 78% to, I think it was 18%, the prevalence of mastitis. In Cambodia, we worked with pork because that's the animal source food of choice in the country. And the issue there was food safety, high levels of salmonella. So we worked with them to reduce the incidence and the prevalence of salmonella in the food chain. So understanding and respecting the culture is very important. But there are times when the culture is includes taboos that are misleading, that result in avoidance of certain animal source foods. Like in some cultures, they say that if women drink milk, it will make them grow beards, or it will block their digestive tracts or something like that. And we may laugh about some of them. People could also laugh about our meatless Monday culture as well. So in those cases, what is needed is evidence-based information, helping to foster behavior change, coming alongside them to help them understand why some of those taboos are misleading.
Yeah, I can just add to that too. I was sitting on the plane yesterday next to a development officer from Jamaica who was saying that their entire beef production really took a huge hit many years ago during the mad cow epidemic. Not because mad cow ever even landed on Jamaica, but because Jamaicans got so scared that they were going to get mad cow that they refused to eat beef, and they still don't really eat beef in Jamaica. So I think we need to really work on just what was just said on evidence-based real science. And what I'm seeing here are there in the US with programs like Meatless Mondays that are spreading misinformation, starting at kindergarten all the way up to inner city kids. You know, that's part of culture too, of modern urban American culture that is also harming young people that need animal source foods as well.
Thank you.
I just want to make a quick comment. I think there's a lot of inequities in terms of consumption if you look at the data. In the southern cone, southern America, that's where the consumption per capita is much higher than what you have in many of the other countries. So one of the things you've seen as the income per capita has been increasing, then the consumption rate for animal proteins have been increasing. A case of China, for example, we've seen that case growing. And of course, what you mentioned in terms of the cultures, based on that, you target what animal proteins can be working on. But recently, we have seen a shift, of course, to the projects you have seen with Bill and Melinda Gates that you presented, a trend in terms of increasing consumption of animal proteins in this region. And I think education and awareness is going to be very important. Yeah, as a kid, when I went to class, I recall that my mother, as well as the teachers, they mentioned to you that milk is very important as a source of nutrient. I couldn't believe that after 40 or 50 years, a discussion is about not drinking meat or eat animal protein. So you can see how the debate has changed over time.
Dr. Ibrahim, I want to keep with you. I've heard from several folks about the idea of a transition from animal agriculture, and I want to ask you about the consequences of that and some of the impacts that would have on farmers and you know what the maybe some of the unintended consequences would be of that concept.
Well, I think generally farmers now have accepted the importance of adopting the good practices that they need to do to cope with a changing climate. I think that this debate has been more towards mitigation to climate change, but I am of the opinion that you need to look at the question of adaptation to climate change, understanding the synergies between adaptation and mitigation to climate change when you look at how much the farmers are losing through the drought or flooded conditions we have seen in the case of Central America. So how do you help them to look at risk management and uncertainty that to offset some of the problems they have? And we see a positive trend where the governments and the policymakers now are putting much more attention in terms of promoting incentives to the farmers for transitioning to this. Costa Rica is one of the countries that, to my opinion, has been a champion in terms of transition. Uruguay has been a country also mentioned today, based on my knowledge in terms of what I know in terms of Central America and South America. They've already got a platform for the low carbon livestock systems. And also they have an incentive schemes which are promoting a payment for ecosystem services to farmers, which includes the livestock farmers for adopting good practices on the farms.
I want to add a different dimension, maybe a different answer to that question. This is to do with some groups that are promoting avoidance of animal agriculture. And I'll use two extremes. In the West, in the US, a study was done some years ago to look at what would happen if the recommendations of those groups are upheld, if we get rid of animal agriculture completely. And the discovery was that the reduction in greenhouse gas emissions was quite small, was only by 2%. You know, a lot of what you hear would give the impression that there'll be a very drastic reduction, but no, it was 2%. But what was also worrying, or very worrying, was that nutrient deficiencies would then dominate, would then become very prevalent. A lot of the nutrient deficiencies that we only read about in history books would then become much more common. And of course, this would be huge, hugely disruptive to livelihoods. So that's in the US. Now, in the African countries where we work, you know, 80%, you know, just 3 weeks ago, I was in Ethiopia and I asked one of my colleagues, how many lives here, how many people's lives depend on livestock? And he said, probably 80%. This is the same statistic I hear in Burkina Faso, in Niger, where I go there, where, you know, livestock contribute to 40% of agricultural GDP. So in those contexts, telling people to get rid of livestock is like saying, do away with your main source of livelihood. So I think it's very important for us to realize that those ideas, whether it's for the West or the Global South, are just simply untenable. Thank you.
Just gonna add one more thing to that, because the study that you just mentioned also showed that if we reduce or eliminate livestock, obesity and overall calorie consumption would have to go up. So in a country like America, where 70% are overweight or obese, you know, you have to eat so many more calories worth of beans and rice to get the same nutrients you can get in a very small amount of meat. So when we talk about nutrient deficiencies, but meat is also a solution for obesity as well, because it's so satiating. You're just so full on such a small amount of calories because of the high protein and high nutrient value.
Hello, very nice presentations. Very good. Very interesting. My name is Agustin. I'm from Uruguay. And I have a question, because you have mentioned many times the carbon neutral or zero emissions meat. And I have been working in certification in meat, carbon neutral meat in Uruguay. And the question is, two questions in one. What do you think is the role of CATI or the public sector in general terms in this matter? And the second part is, what do you think is the future of this type of certification?
Well, I think the role of, I will give an example of the public sector, is really to look at providing the incentives for transitioning towards what practices the farmers have to adopt. Costa Rica created a platform for when you and this integrates the It's include the private sector, the university and research centers, and also the decision makers in terms of what policies you need to put up. But I think the role of the public sector is to try to also look at the linkages for markets, for promoting the incentives that farmers will need, and also the private sector is part of this platform that we work on. Providing the incentives to farmers for adopting the technologies, but also looking at the markets. I understood that the markets are growing. Yesterday in a panel, they mentioned that there's a big demand for carbon neutral beef, but the supply is not, the chain is not there. So your second question, I couldn't recall. The future for that, I think that if you look at what the countries are planning in terms of the NDCs, you can see many of the countries are integrating livestock in the NDCs as a part of the solution. And also we have already more than 15 countries in Latin America towards this pathway. So I think now the discussion is more towards looking at how can you have a transition towards this low carbon livestock systems.
Thank you, and thank you for the presentation. Very interesting. I think one of the presenters referenced the issue of addressing taboos, you know, as a hindrance. My question goes in the other sense. I remember a few years ago, the Caribbean had a vibrant coconut oil industry. And then you had all kinds of propaganda about coconut oil causing heart attack, cholesterol, and then there was promotion of vegetable oil. Now we've seen a lot of that was a fallacy, and nowadays we are reverting to coconut oil and virgin coconut oil as the fix-it-all. To what extent, from your view, that the Western business model should be regulated in the way they operate and practice what they do? Because now you all present the dilemma of the demonization of meat in promotion of veggie products, and we've seen an emergence of all the veggie products. To what extent that business model should be regulated in all these negotiations and talk that we are dealing with?
Thank you for the question. I think it's about to what extent should the business model be regulated. I think the key thing here is that any regulations should be evidence-based. And it's very easy to jump on the bandwagon, especially when you have some very noisy sectors that are able to whip up public sentiment. But it's very, very important that everything goes back down to sound science and is backed by sound science. And this is something we have to work with our policymakers on. In all the countries where we work, the government is our first partner, and we make sure that we try and help them see which of their policies are being implemented, which of them are not, what are the reasons why, but to what extent are their policies evidence-based? And if they're not, what can we do about it? I'll give you one example. In Ethiopia in 2015, there was a publication about the levels of aflatoxin in milk. And somebody took one of those, took that information and posted on social media, the milk from Ethiopia is unsafe. It almost crashed the dairy industry. People stopped drinking milk. So since then, we've had to work. The government has been working actively. We've paid maybe a small role in that. And we've done that in some other countries to try and help to figure out the best way of informing the public about these issues in a balanced way that doesn't cause alarm. For instance, I mentioned the issue with aflatoxin levels in milk being a hazard. It is a hazard. But when you think about the risk, the true risk, the reason why we consume, why the action levels for aflatoxin in food items is mainly cancer. But when you look at the milk aflatoxin to cancer link, it's really not there, or it's hardly there. And so it's important to then work with the policymakers to look at the science and to then help them to change the policies. So absolutely those regulations have to be evidence-based, whether they are for the West or whether they're for the global South. Thank you.
So we have just a minute left, and I want to close with a general question. We all agree that we need to work towards a climate-friendly food system. What is animal protein and livestock's role in a climate-friendly food system? Who wants to start?
Well, I think livestock has a big role to play, because clearly livestock contribute to the emissions. But I think, you know, what Frank shared from UC Davis shows that a lot of the impression out there about the pollution from livestock is wrong, and the contributions are less than a lot of people think they are. But nevertheless, there are livestock does contribute to emissions. And so it's vitally important that we adopt climate smart approaches, whether we're in the global north or in the global south, and that we have more sustainable livestock production systems. When I talk to our farmers in Florida, I tell them this is a win-win, because if you can reduce carbon emissions, methane emissions from beef cattle, from dairy cattle, guess where the energy that would be lost as methane is going? It's going to the growth of the animal. It's going to milk production. So you're going to increase the productivity of the animal while saving the planet. So it's a win-win, and it's definitely something we should all actively participate in. Thank you.
I'd like to see the conversation go from only looking at carbon emissions to ecosystem function, overall ecosystem function. And I think that the livestock industry, instead of just reacting, can actually be proactive about that and talk more about that. And on the food side, to go away from calorie production and talk about nutrient production. So we have healthy people and healthy planet, and not just plants for the win and carbon emissions.
My impression is a discussion about the intake of the livestock meat and milk is more related to the global demands, which is projected to increase by 70% over the next 50 years or so. So the question of why the discussion of intake is related to what the impacts on climate change that you're going to have. But of course, if you look at the system boundaries at the farm level, if we can look at alternatives for looking at more carbon neutrality and reducing the emissions, I think the issue is going to be there, but also promoting more responsible consumption is going to be very critical, as we have seen in the debates. So there are already good technologies. What we need to do is looking at the policies, look how can you scale up these policies through incentives to help people to remove the barriers that you're having in that.
Well, thank you to all our panelists. Really appreciate you participating with us today. Thanks for everybody for joining us. Yeah. Okay.